can start now.
Welcome you all to the second webinar organized by the ICSI Institute of Insolvency Professionals in respect of fraudulent transactions under Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. The topic is gaining attention as in many cases under IBC, as we call the buffet transactions, have been reported. The spirit of the law is very clear with respect to addressing the preferential, undervalued, extortionate and fraudulent transactions. In fact, the concept of fraudulent preference existed both in the Companies Act 1956 and the Companies Act 2013. However, the provisions pertaining to undervalued and fraudulent transactions are unique in the code, which are adopted from the UK Insolvency Act 1986. The BLRC referred to Section 243 of the UK Insolvency Act 1986 and recommended that the provisions voiding transactions defrauding the creditors should be included in the code. It observed there should be stricter scrutiny for transactions of fraudulent preference or transfer to related parties, for which it mentioned that the look back provisions be also the look back period should be specified in the regulations. Going forward, the Insolvency Law Committee in its report in March 2018 amended Section 69 to delete the words on or after the insolvency commencement date, which allowed the action to be taken in respect of transaction defrauding creditors which had occurred much before the initiation of the insolvency proceedings. The relevant provisions of the code which deal with the irregular transactions include sections 43 to 51 as well as sections 66 and 67, and the provisions related to offences and penalties are covered under section 68 to 77 of the code. The importance of these sections can be gauged from the following facts, and as reported, the forensic audit of over 200 companies facing corporate insolvency resolution action under IBC has revealed irregularities of more than 1 lakh crore, including the possible diversion of funds. This is a huge sum. In most of the cases, the forensic audit was initiated at the behest of the resolution professionals or the IRPs appointed by NCLT. In a majority of even the 12 high profile cases referred to action by the Reserve Bank of India, the irregularities have been noticed in at least 8 of such cases, some of which are also being probed separately by agencies such as Serious Fraud Investigation Office. Considering that such transactions need to be deliberated upon by insolvency professionals as well as other professionals and stakeholders, for today's webinar, the Chairman IBBI, Dr. M.S. Sahu himself is here to throw some light and bring clarity on the critical aspects. Thank you so much, sir, and we welcome you today. We also have with us the eminent counsel member of ICSI, Mr. Siddharth Murarka, who is practicing company secretary, having vast experience in company law, NCLT matters, legal risk management and compliance matters. Welcome, Mr. Murarka.
Thank you, madam.
We also have with us a renowned insolvency professional, Ms. Ramanathan Bhuvneshwari. Friends, who has handled 4 CIRP assignments, of which in 3 cases she has filed applications under Section 66. She will of course deal with these sections and try to apprise the nuances involved in making applications under Section 66. But I would just like to quote that even in the case of Tej Kamal Pharmaceutical Private Limited, wherein she made an application under 66, which was forwarded to SFIU, and thereafter the case was fully settled. Here the Provident Fund Department complimented the RP that this being the first case where the department got full recovery. It goes to her credit. The responsibility for making applications under the code, under Section 66, lie primarily with the insolvency professionals. and therefore they need to understand their duties and responsibilities as well as the ethical aspect involved in respect of this, this major huge responsibility which has been cast upon them. Friends, fraudulent transactions are pushing companies into insolvency, and value maximization of a company under insolvency can happen only if the money siphoned off is put back to the company, which is a responsibility enshrined upon by the and upon the insolvency professionals. With these few words, I request Mr. Murarka to kindly share his version on the topic, and thereafter I would request Sahu sir to share his very important the opinion that he has with regard to the responsibilities of the RP in this aspect with all of you. Mr. Murarka, please.
Thank you, madam. I am indeed grateful to the Institute of Company Secretaries of India and ICSI IIP for this opportunity, and I am glad to be amongst Dr. M.S. Sahu, Honorable Chairperson of IBBI, C.S. Alka Arora, CEO of ICSI IIP, and C.S. Bhuvaneshwari Ramanathan, Insolvency Professional from Bangalore. Friends, a very good afternoon. This is indeed a very important topic, because the insolvency professionals and IBC professionals, we have come forward a long way. And this is probably an area which needs more discussion. So friends, before we talk about fraudulent transactions, I would like to go to the genesis of the corporate structure. You know, we have a board at the board level and shareholders at the shareholders level. These are the two structures which govern a company. The shareholders are the owners of the company, and the board of directors have fiduciary responsibility for running the organization. Now, having said so, why this fiduciary responsibility is important? When we go through several provisions of this IBC code, right from section 41 to 53 and 66, 67, we will find that the legislature has cast an obligation on the board to see that they should have ought to know the solvency or insolvency position of the company. This responsibility on the board cannot be done away with. Now, before I speak or share my thoughts on these sections, I draw attention of everyone to Regulation 35A of the CIRP regulation. Regulation 35A talks about the duty of the resolution professional to form an opinion, after forming the opinion, to make a determination, and if such determination is made, then to make an application before the adjudicating authority for seeking appropriate relief. This regulation 35A can also be correlated with section 25 of the code, which casts similar responsibility on resolution professional, and section 35 of the code, which casts similar obligation on a liquidator. So now, reading section 25, 35 of the code and regulation 35A of CIRP regulations, it is very clear that an insolvency professional, whether in the shoes of a RP or in the shoes of a liquidator, cannot escape the responsibility, or he is duty bound, rather I should put it this way, that he is duty bound to form an opinion on such transactions, make the determination, and after such determination, file an application with the Honorable Adjudicating Authority for appropriate reliefs. I now go by the sections. I will not read the sections, but show some important portions from these sections. So friends, section 43, 44 talk about preferential transactions. These preferential transactions are largely understood as a transfer of property or interest for the benefit of a creditor, which puts such creditor in a beneficial position than the creditor would have been in the event of distribution of assets under section 53. Then coming to undervalued transaction, which of course goes on from section 45 to 49, undervalued transactions are largely understood as transactions which are made either in the form of a gift or at a consideration which is significantly lower than the actual consideration. For both these concepts of preferential transaction and undervalued transaction, there is a look back period, or the relevant period, which is 2 years in case the transaction has happened with a related party, or 1 year in case the transaction has happened with another party who is not a related party. When we move further, we find in section 50 and 51 about extortionate credit transaction. These are largely transactions wherein the corporate debtor enters into a financing agreement or a loan agreement and pays an extortionate amount of interest on the debt taken. Even for this provision of extortionate credit transaction, the relevant period is 2 years preceding the ICD, insolvency commencement date. Now, an interesting difference between the provisions from section 43 to 51 and that of 66 and 67 is that under the code, under section 66 and 67, the look back period is not prescribed. Of course, we will have a discussion during this seminar on what are the implications. Can we go back even 5 years or 10 years, or will the look back period apply? Coming to the primary section for which this discussion we are all here today, section 66, the language of section 66 reminds me of the provisions under IPC also. The language says, if during the CIRP process or a liquidation process, it is found that any business of the corporate debtor has been carried on with the intent to defraud creditors or for any fraudulent purpose, the adjudicating authority may pass an order that any person who were knowingly parties to the carrying on of the business in such manner shall be liable to make contribution to the assets of the corporate debtor. Friends, this is something which is a wide power given to the adjudicating authority under all these provisions. I read further because when I started this discussion, I mentioned about the fiduciary responsibility of the directors. Now I read further, section 66 subsection 2. It says that the adjudicating authority may by an order direct that a director of a company or a partner of a LLP, as the case may be, shall be liable to make contribution to assets of the corporate debtor if before the insolvency commencement date, such director or partner knew or ought to have known that there was no reasonable prospect of avoiding the commencement of CIRP in respect of corporate debtor, and such director or partner did not exercise due diligence in minimizing the potential loss to the creditors of the corporate debtor. So it is very clear from the reading of this provision that this fiduciary duty is cast on the directors, and the directors, the management of the corporate debtor, should not unnecessarily avoid ICD or insolvency commencement date and the invocation of CIRP. In fact, Honorable Chairperson of IBBI, subject to correction from him, once the CIRP commences, the personal liability of the director probably ceases. That is my personal view. So, when we see section 67, this section 67 is an extension of section 66, which talks about further powers of the adjudicating authority. However, friends, you will all notice that across these provisions 43 to 51 and 66 and 67, the word used is any person. So when the adjudicating authority passes any order, it can actually pass an order on any person. And for the sake of reference, I read from the code, section 44 subsection 1, the adjudicating authority may, on an application made by the resolution professional or liquidator by an order, require any person to pay such sums in respect of benefits received by him from the corporate debtor, such sums to the liquidator or resolution professional as the adjudicating authority may direct. So, one, it can require anyone to make contribution, it can give directions in the nature of restitution, it can cancel transactions, even movable or immovable. At the same time, very interesting provision under section 67 clause 1A, which says that the adjudicating authority may provide for a liability of any person under the order to be a charge on any debt or obligation due from the corporate debtor to him. So, this is a very innovative kind of drafting or provision, which says that if somebody owes something from the corporate debtor, but he has entered into such a transaction, then his rights would be like a charge against the receipt of from the corporate debtor. So, very innovative. I think I would stop here for the timing, and once we hear Honorable Dr. Sahu sir, then probably we will again discuss.
Sahu sir, you please.
Thank you very much. Thanks to ICSI and ICSI Institute of Insolvency Professionals for inviting me to this webinar. I know we have the experts who would talk about the nitty-gritty of the provisions and their implementation. I would be very briefly touching upon the basic spirit of behind these provisions, which is in fact the main objective of this insolvency and bankruptcy code. We know when a firm, a corporate debtor is in distress, financial distress or economic distress, that means the value of the enterprise is subdued. This has to go through a process called reorganization or insolvency resolution for maximization of value of assets of the corporate debtor. The basic provisions in the code 2016, thereafter two amendments, and the third amendment bill which is in parliament, which was introduced day before in the Rajya Sabha, all these aim to subserve only one objective of the code, that is the insolvency resolution for value maximization, maximization of value of assets of the corporate debtor. And I observe that it has been the constant endeavor of the state, particularly the recommendations of the insolvency law committee, that let us do everything possible to facilitate recovery of a value, retrieve the value if it has been lost somewhere, or whatever is left, let's get best out of it. Let me take you very briefly through this amendment bill, how some of these focus on value maximization. We believed that the resolution plan as defined in the code meant a plan that resolves insolvency of the corporate debtor as a going concern. There was a question mark if the corporate debtor does not continue to exist as a going concern, is still a resolution not possible? Should the corporate debtor continue to exist post resolution? We had this problem in the very first resolution approved under the code on 2nd August 2017 in the matter of Synergies Durep Automotives Private Limited. The resolution plan provided for amalgamation of this unit to another unit called Synergy Castings. That resolution plan was challenged under several grounds before the NCLAT, including one ground that the law never anticipated that the corporate debtor will be extinguished as a part of the resolution plan. But as we know from the long title of the code that it is the insolvency resolution of the person, essentially the revival of the company, continuation of the business, and section and regulation 37 specifically provided that there can be mergers or combinations kind of things with one or more persons. So, given these provisions, NCLAT upheld the resolution plan of Synergies and held that merger or amalgamation is permissible even if the corporate debtor extinguished. So, the new amendment now says that because resolution plan was left to the imagination of the stakeholders, whatever can increase the value, whatever can resolve the insolvency is acceptable. Now, it is very explicitly stated that any form of restructuring such as merger, amalgamation, takeover, anything is permissible whatever adds a value to the assets of the corporate debtor. And all along we knew that the objective of the code has been time-bound resolution. We wanted the resolution process should start as early as it is possible, possibly at the first instance of the default of a threshold amount. Stakeholders are entitled to apply for the admission or initiation of a CIRP, but we noticed that applications were filed, but some of them or many of them were not admitted expeditiously within statutory 14 days, which was held to be mandatory by the NCLAT as well as the Honorable Supreme Court. Recently, we had a direction from Honorable NCLAT to NCLT Allahabad to dispose of the application in respect of JP Associates Limited, which was pending for about 8-9 months. Any delay we know causes a depletion of the value. The more we delay, the becomes more difficult to rescue a company. Therefore, an application remaining pending long at the adjudicating authority was a cause of concern. Again, in one of the matters NCLAT in Surendra Trading Corporation, it mentioned that under certain facts and circumstances, if there is adequate justification, the adjudicating authority can record the reasons in writing for such a delay. Now we know that the default is a much more objective measure as compared to net worth in the erstwhile regime. Default in respect of financial debt is much more clean than in respect of an operational debt. This bill now says that at least in respect of default in a financial debt, the adjudicating authority is not able to dispose of an application within 14 days. Let it at least record the reason why it took longer time. Similarly, the argument in respect of the closure of the CIRP of 180 within 180 days extendable by one time extension up to 90 days, but we know it has not been happening in many cases, and this has also the potential to reduce the possibility of a revival. Many more companies may go into liquidation if the state of uncertainty continues for long. And we know that in quite a few cases, the litigation is taking time. The Honorable Supreme Court in one matter told that since the courts can do no harm to man, and in NCLAT, in one matter specified certain circumstances when the time used in the litigation or certain specific purposes can be excluded from the timeline given under the CIRP. So, it has been a matter of practice for the stakeholders to seek exclusion of time out of the CIRP period and to reduce that possibility, and in any case it must conclude. The law now provides that including the litigation, including the judicial process, a resolution process must conclude in 330 days, failing which the company must be liquidated. So, both starting early, closing early aim at preserving the value of the enterprise or maximizing the value. Similarly, we know that recently NCLAT has made it clear that the dues of government are the operational debt. Government is an operational creditor, and resolution plans once approved under section 31 is binding on all stakeholders including creditors, debtors, members, and of course government as an operational creditor. But it was not easy to accept. Some people could not accept this, that the government dues, despite the provision in the liquidation waterfall, if the dues, government dues, have not been fully paid, being an operational creditor, government is entitled to liquidation value, which could be very minimum, insignificant, or even zero in some cases. There was a feeling that government could make a claim against the corporate debtor post resolution, and that was creating uncertainty. And therefore, it was discouraging the potential resolution applicants to submit resolution plans. Now, it has been made clear that any resolution plan approved by the adjudicating authority is binding on central government, state government, or any local authority whosoever was to get any money from the corporate debtor under any law. Similarly, we had the provision in section 33 that because our law does not allow liquidation as a direct measure, even though the World Bank expects us that one should be allowed to initiate the resolution process or liquidation process, but we wanted that let us start the resolution process, let the stakeholders come together and then take a joint view if the company is not viable and has to be liquidated. So, we assign that the responsibility to committee of creditors, and we expected that as soon as a committee of creditors is constituted, it should be willing to take a decision to liquidate the company if it finds that helps the value of the firm. But we came across a few instances where NCLT and NCLAT all along there is a preference for resolution. It was expected that the whole process of a resolution one should go through till we conclude that resolution is absolutely not possible, then we go for liquidation. By that time value would have depleted further. Despite the explicit provision, now further it is reinforced that the committee of creditors can decide to liquidate a company even before preparation of information memorandum, invitation of expression of interest. All these are intended to capture the value, to prevent further erosion of the value, and whatever value remains, let's make maximum use of this, best use of this. Those of you who have gone through the Bankruptcy Law Reforms Committee, it particularly mentioned two sources of value. One can have additional value from two sources. One was that the sale of the corporate debtor as a going concern after a liquidation order has been passed. If there is value in business, nobody took over the corporate debtor, but there could be a person who is interested to take over a business of the corporate debtor or entire corporate debtor. The liquidation regulation 32 provided that the liquidator can sell the company as a going concern or the business of the company as a going concern. And BLRC believed that selling as a composite whole can give a better value than selling them in piecemeal. To operationalize that provision, IBBI has yesterday issued the liquidation amendment regulations providing for such sale and details of the process. It also provides timelines and so many other things. But to enable the stakeholders go for sale as a going concern and even for the insolvency professional to benefit from the advice of the stakeholders, the amendment regulation yesterday provides for constitution of a stakeholders consultation committee to guide the liquidator on sale of the assets. Another source of value which a BLRC has identified is these avoidance transactions. Possibly the value has moved away in the last few years, maybe in the last few days, to somewhere else, and that money needs to be retrieved. We have four kinds of irregular transactions, and the resolution professional has been given the responsibility to find out if there has been any such irregular transaction and bring it to the notice of the adjudicating authority so that the value lost can be retrieved. Section 66(2) in particular talks about that the directors of the company are responsible for any loss in value. In the earlier categories like irregular transactions, fraudulent transactions, preferential transactions, we know value has gone to a certain person which can be brought back. But under Section 66(2), it may not be possible to know where the value has gone, but it is possible to know on because of whose conduct the value has gone. And whose conduct essentially means the conduct of the board of directors or every director on the board. Once these directors have known or ought to have known that it is inevitable that the corporate debtor will get into a resolution process,
despite that they continued business, that means they did business at the cost of the creditors. When the company is already incurring loss, the value of the equity is exhausted, company has defaulted in payment of corporate creditors, and it still continues to business means it is eating up the whatever available for the creditors. So therefore, the directors have an additional responsibility beyond fiduciary responsibility provided under section 166 to take extra care to ensure that the interest of creditors are protected, or at least their value left for them is not depleted any further. So this period is called twilight zone, that is the time from when this company it was inevitable for the company to get into resolution process till the time actually it went into resolution process. Any loss occurring during this twilight period, the directors are responsible to make it good. We have seen a few cases where an application is filed for initiation of a CIRP, generally the board of directors resist the admission into CIRP. But please note that the more the delay in admission, because company is now surviving on the creditors money, the longer the admission is delayed, the loss to creditors increases and therefore liability of the directors increases. So resistance to admission into CIRP further increases the liability of the directors. And I am sure the insolvency professionals, what Madam Alka Kapoor told, that so many applications have been filed, have been able to dig up that so many irregular transactions have happened, and there are programs to build their capacity, how to detect such things, how to define when twilight zone begins, when twilight zone ends, and what process should be followed thereafter, including the criminal action. And some of you may have seen there have been a few orders in the recent past. One is Cumin Properties, one is Liberty House, where the NCLAT has sought, impleaded IBBI and government how to deal with certain situations when there are certain criminal things are noticed. So it's better that the insolvency professionals who are the eyes and ears of the state and have in fact the statutory responsibility, being the officers of the court, have a very vigilant eye to unearth any such irregular thing that has happened and thereby bring value on the table, and that is the job of the insolvency professional. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Definitely, RPs are the officers of the court and therefore they have a great responsibility on their shoulders. And sir, the RPs are, to a great extent, they are reporting these cases and therefore trying to fulfill their responsibilities. With these words, I now request Madam Bhuvneshwari to kindly share her perspective, how as an IP she handled the cases and how she made the applications, and what was it that she found out which she wants other professionals also to follow. She is, in fact, friends, she is joining us from a different place, and therefore I request the organizers to kindly shift over to her.
Good evening, everybody. You see, he says it's not connected. Hi, good evening. Hello.
Good evening.
I think you can start.
Good evening.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Nice to be here in front of the veterans and also the regulator. It's a great privilege to me, and I'm really happy to share my experience with all the fellow professionals. In fact, today I am branded as the Section 66 RP. So I want more and more professionals to use Section 66. To maximize the assets under the code to protect the interest of the stakeholders. So what I am planning to do is that I would like to just focus on Section 66(1) because that is where, you know, the professional needs to understand very clearly. I am trying to combine the theory with my practice so that, you know, the professionals understand very clearly how it's they need to act on it. So to start with section 661, I'm not planning to read the section, but I want to dissect the section into various small parts. First, it says during CIRP or liquidation process, it is found. Where, in fact, in this context, what I would like to say is that section 66 is the section, in fact, avoidable transactions and section 66 are the transaction sections, which by positioning itself, it has come to the later part of the CIRP. So that, you know, the earlier part, we do a lot of compliance, right, from inviting the clients, you know, advertising Form G and various other things, resolution process and all. It's more of compliance, and if no resolution plan is approved or received, then you get into liquidation. So, yes, it's a compliance process. That's how I look at it. But at the same time, section 43, the avoidable transactions, and section 66, fraudulent transaction, is where our real business understanding comes into place. How we understand the business. And though it is positioned at the fag end of the CIRP, I would say, you know, within the first 30 days, in fact, regulation says that within 75 days, one needs to form an opinion on the fraudulent transaction. But I would say that's a too long period. Within the first 30 days, first 20 days, we are supposed to look at the 2 months, 2 years financials. That is the period we need to understand that whether there's a fraudulent transaction or not, you know. And in fact, the first application of mine, I was filed within 45 days of initiation of CIRP. It's a very complex case. But we could do it. In the first COC meeting, what we all do, the general agenda is that the IRP has to be either approved as an appointed as RP or a new RP is appointed. That's the only point, mainly I understand it's coming in the first COC meeting. But in my opinion, the first COC meeting, the first agenda item is to talk about the financial status of the business, of the company, and how the resolution professional looks at the business. Is it healthy? What sort of resolution is possible? Is there any avoidable transaction? Is there any diversion of funds? What is the resolution or the solution for the stakeholders? That is what is most important, I feel. Once you come out with that sort of plan, clarity, and in the first COC meeting, you talk about it, why the COC has to replace a professional, bring some other RP, they will definitely appoint you. In fact, in my first COC meeting of Tej Kamal, again, it was a shell company. And when I went through the details, I came to know that the factory, only revenue earning or undertaking of the company was sold 2 years before the insolvency commencement date. Insolvency, you know, it was somewhere in 2015, it was sold. And when I took over a shell company with only liabilities, and financial creditor was settled, only operational creditors, including PF department and IT department, were there. So in the first COC meeting, I told them that the only way is to file application under section 66 and fight it out legally. They asked me, the COC members, 17 COC members were there. They asked me, are you confident, madam? We have to go by your confidence. I said, this is there's a lot of violations I have observed. The sale is an illegal sale. Let us fight on it. Then they approved my appointment as RP. Within 45 days of my appointment, I filed the application. And, in this, the violations, I came across several violations. The factory, you know, the bare fact was that the full factory was a running company with 150 employees. They sold the factory in the form of assets. There is a seller, corporate debtor, there is a buyer. They entered into 4 different agreements. One agreement for sale of land, one agreement for sale of buildings, one agreement for sale of plant and machinery, one agreement for consumables. All same seller, same buyer, same date. It was executed. And I first realized that, you know, number one, there's a violation. It's an agricultural land on which they constructed the factory. That is a violation of the Agricultural Land Reforms Act, you know, as per Karnataka regulations. Number two, this is a going concern. When a company is a going concern, how can they do the sale of assets? Sale of assets is possible if you do the Control F search under the Companies Act. The sale of assets appears first time under Section 277 of the Companies Act, that is on liquidation. So when a company is a going concern, Section 180 explanation says that if there are revenue reported in the previous 12 months, then it is a going concern. This company is a going concern. How can you sell it as sale of assets? They said the respondents argued that anybody can sell any asset to anybody. Then I had to look into the Transfer of Property Act. The TP Act, Section 5 says that with respect to sale to a company or sale from a company, the applicable laws applicable to the companies are to be looked at. So applicable law for the company is company law. Company law does not approve sale of assets which is a going concern. So if at all the factory has to be sold, there are two ways of selling a factory. One is this party did an OTS with a financial creditor. So Section 230 is attracted as an arrangement. Then under Section 232, he should have sold it by conducting the creditors meeting, getting 75% approval of the creditors, settle the creditors and move forward. So Section 230, 232 was not followed. Or the other possibility of selling this factory is under Section 242C of the Income Tax Act as a slum sale. Under slum sale, either the creditors are to be settled or they have to be carried forward along with the assets. So in any way, the creditors' interest is protected under Section 242C of the Income Tax Act or under Section 230 and 232 of the Companies Act. Now, they did not follow both. They did an asset sale as if the company is on liquidation when the company was a live going concern. So that is a violation I took. Second violation what I took was there was an application filed in front of the High Court for winding up. Creditor had filed a winding up petition which was transferred to NCLT through which I was appointed as a resolution professional. So before the winding up petition was filed, before the sale of the factory. So when the factory winding up is on, how can they sell a factory? In fact, the adjudicating authority told me that the High Court has not passed order. So no winding up is in progress. Then I went through the Companies Act. Section 357 of the Companies Act says that as soon as the winding up application is presented, filed with the High Court, winding up process starts. So during the winding up process, Section 334 says that no transfer of property can be made. And if a transfer is made, it is void. So I took that. So violation of Section 357, read with Section 334, Section 230, 232 violation, Section 242C violation, agricultural land reforms violation. And the promoter also, whatever is the money received, he siphoned it off. He paid himself and his other relatives instead of paying the creditors. So these are all siphoning of the funds. With all these, I filed an application. And after 22 hearings, the adjudicating authority asked me, Bhuvaneshwari, what recourse you have got if we don't pass order? So I went to NCLAT. I realized that they are not going to pass orders. I went to NCLAT, took a direction. And then the NCLT adjudicating authority was forced to pass an order. They passed an order forwarding it to SFIO on the 270th day. Then again, I went on appeal. And by then, you know, they realized that SFIO is a serious investigation. And the buyer is a company, big company with operations in 78 countries. So they realized the seriousness of it. They came back and settled everything, including CARP costs and all the operational creditors, 100%. So this is a case where how to maximize the value when you get many of the companies. In fact, the first three companies of my assignment, all are shell companies, you know. So how do you maximize the assets? And in fact, today I would say that the fraudulent promoters are making good use of the IBC. They are using IBC as a tool to walk away by avoiding the liabilities than be professionals using the same Section 66. you know, somehow they enter through Section 7, through Section 9, through Section 10. They make application just to push the company into liquidation. So this is my experience. So three cases, first three applications, cases of mine, Section 66, I filed application. The adjudicating authority did not appreciate it because they thought, I'm wasting their time. They did not appreciate it. You know, and so that is the most, how do you maximize the assets? So within the 30 days, we should be able to understand what are we going to do with this company? Why the business has failed? So within 30 days, talk to the promoter to find out why his business failed. Talk to the auditors to get their views. Talk to creditors, talk to suppliers, talk to ex-employee, talk to present employee. All of us will come out with one story. The promoter will say demonetization, GST and all other things, economy is down and all that. Then, but you will get an idea. So within 30 days and also the books, with that information, if you go through the books, you will be able to make out that whether there's a fraud or not. And also I would like to talk about what is the fraud? How do you find out the fraud? The fraud is not visible through a normal eye. We have to understand the business, understand the laws, you know, and then, you know, many of these illegal transactions are done in a very legal manner. And the professionals are involved. The professionals are supporting the promoters in, you know, in these transactions. So we have to be extra smart. Understanding the law, understanding the business is very important. Then only we'll be able to do it. So I just want to bring Section 447 of the Companies Act explanation where the fraud is clearly defined. That is the only place where the fraud is defined. Under IBC, there's no definition of fraud. Under the Companies Act, the fraud is defined under the explanation that any act or omission of any fact or abuse of any position committed by any person or any other person with the connivance in any manner with the intent to deceive or to gain undue advantage from or to injure the interest of the company or its shareholders or its creditors or any other person, whether or not there's any wrongful gain or wrongful loss. In fact, this is the only place the fraud is maintained. So what I understand from this section is that any fraud, any act or omission which is going to injure the upright debtor or the creditors. From the IBC angle, when I look at it, this is what it is. Anything injurious to the shareholders is called as fraud. We can straight away take it. And the second part of the thing, you know, what we need to do is business is carried on with intent to defraud the creditors of the CD or for any fraudulent purpose. So how do we do that? How do we prove the intention of the creditors? Intention to defraud the creditors. That is the most fraud we can find out. But how do you prove the intention? They generally say that it's a routine transaction. There are so many transactions between the corporate debtor and the group companies, which are told us business, normal business transactions. Many times they are not at arm's length pricing, arm's length transactions, and money is siphoned off. There are a lot of receivables due from the group companies. The promoters do not put in any effort to recover those monies. They just leave it. And the promoters resign, the directors resign, bringing in a dummy director, and then they file through a group company, they file an application in NCLT. You know, so that the company can be liquidated. These are all modus operandi which is used by the promoters generally to walk off freely, defrauding the creditors. And, you know, fraudulent purposes, you know, there may be round tripping of transactions. There are fictitious transactions. Money is borrowed, you know, diverted. They borrow the money, divert it to the group companies. Year on year, it appears in the audited results. Nobody is bothered. It is filed in MCA site also, but nobody is bothered. But we, the professionals, should go through the audited balance sheet. In the front part of the balance sheet, you will not be able to make out anything. Go to the schedules and sub-schedules to find out what is the breakup of the transactions, where the money is going. Related party transactions are very clearly mentioned in the audited balance sheet. That is very important place where one can lay his hand, because what are the money due from the company, from the group companies, we can make out very easily. I also want to talk about the intention in the case of JP Infra case. The Allahabad bench has passed an order in the case of JP Infra where, you know, the intention is very clearly shown. That's the only order we have got in the country, to my knowledge, where the fraud under Section 66. you know, I just want to read out a part of it where, you know, around 850 acres of land was given as a mortgage to the loan availed by the holding company, Jayaprakash Associates Limited. So JP, and for which there was no consideration received, no counter guarantee was given. The NCLT reasoned that the land so mortgaged could have been, instead of being sold by JIL to meet its payment obligations to its financial creditors and deliver the flats to home buyers. Despite this, JIL directors had entered into the impugned transactions in utter disregard of their fiduciary obligations. They have failed to exercise due diligence in minimizing the potential losses to JIL creditors while instead providing benefits to JIL's related party. So that's why this is the timing of the transaction is considered as the intention. When this company is working for, suffering for working capital, somebody else is enjoying the property. So the timing is a wrong timing. So it's a fraudulent transaction. Intention is wrong. Absence of counter guarantee and consideration from JIL. It amounts to asset stripping. Absence of lenders and shareholders' approval. That is also a fraudulent intention. Creation of mortgage contrary to the decision of JLF. Again, it's a fraudulent intention. That's how they are able to prove that the intention is wrong. The transaction may be giving it to the related party, but where is the consideration? Where is the counter guarantee? Where is the approval? And hence, it's a fraudulent transaction, that too when your company is suffering for working capital. So this is what is happening in various companies, especially in companies what I have dealt with. The group companies take away all the assets and the corporate debtor suffers, and there's no effort from anybody. It's very, very clear. Only thing is, you have to prove it. How do you prove? You know, and also to with respect to the intent of fraud, circumstantial evidences you can bring, legal sections you can bring, like how I talked about 357, 334, section 230, 232, violations. What are the various, whatever be the violation, one should be able to combine it with law and say that this is the law, this is the objective of the law, this is the violation of the section, these are the parties behind it, and hence this application. Unless we are able to bring it that way, adjudicating authority will not appreciate your application. Asset stripping and all that, asset stripping is very common. So, but we should be able to do. In fact, I want to bring to your notice, to the notice of the participants here, all the IPs, the RBI master circular, where there are around 40 to 45 incidents of early warning signals, EWS. I request each one of you to go through the RBI master circular. I will read out a few of them. In fact, we will know what are the things which may be, that's a good indication of fraud, which we can definitely observe during the first 30 days. Raid by income tax, sales tax, central excise duty officials. Means somebody else has already got an indication that there's a fraud taking place. That's an indication for us. Funds coming from other banks to liquidate the outstanding loan of one bank. Requests received from the borrower to postpone the inspection of godown for flimsy reasons. In fact, this happens when we want to go and visit the factory. Somebody will fall sick, mother will fall sick, he is not available, some other, he is self is sick, he is hospitalized. All these reasons are very clear indication. Accounts, they don't give you the accounts, they don't give you the records. These are all very clear indications that they are trying to hide something, they are buying time to manipulate. As simple as that. And financing the unit far away from the bank branch. Floating front and associate companies by investing borrowed money. In fact, I am handling two assignments where they are the subcontract arms for the group companies. Generally, even I spoke to one of the big four firms also. The opinion is that the subcontract arms are floated just for siphoning off for borrowing funds. I have, in my case, the subcontract arm is borrowing funds, assets are in the holding companies, you know, and the transactions, they do only, full-fledged service only to the group companies. Once they realize that, you know, if they are not able to generate more black money, their assets are diverted, bank money, enough they have borrowed, then they try to wind it up. And now IBC is a very good tool for them to wind up the companies. Section 9, Section 7, Section 10, all the sections are being used in front of our eyes. And reduction in the promoter director, stake of the promoters directors, resignation of key personnel and frequent changes in the management, substantial increase in unbilled revenue year on year, large number of transactions with interconnected companies, and large outstanding from group companies. These are all normal things which we can make out in our financials. Significant movements in inventory, disproportionately higher than the growth in the turnover. I have seen inventories which have been maintained at a very good level till the bank borrowings were required or bank loan enhancements are required. Afterwards, the assets, the inventory has vanished. Normally, in a manufacturing company, 40 to 60% is the consumption or 80% is the consumption, material consumption. All of a sudden, next year, it goes to 200% consumption, inventory vanishes, and then further losses, then the company comes into IBC. So it's a very clear indication, you know, the receivables vanishing, inventory vanishing, you know, these are all very simple things to understand that there is a fraud, there are manipulation of the books, no confirmation from the debtors. For namesake, the receivables are on paper, but not, no money is going to be received. Inventory, you can't make out. Assets, you don't know where they are. Simple. We professionals can make out the fraud very easily. Substantial related party transactions, material discrepancies in the audited report, qualified audited reports, movement of account from one bank to another, high-valued RTGS payments to unrelated parties, heavy cash withdrawals from the loan accounts. These are all, you know, I have just highlighted, I'm just highlighting some of the things. Kindly go through the RBI master circular. It's an eye-opener. And we should make use of this, circular. And also, you know, the how do you prove the fraud? Okay, you have made a formed an initial opinion, but what do you do further? How do you prove the fraud? You have to prove the fraud. Do we need to do a forensic audit in all the cases? In out of my three cases where I have filed Section 66, only in one case I did a forensic audit. Other two applications, in one case I submitted statutory audit reports, statutory financials, where the auditor has very clearly shown that the money due from the group companies are in violation of Section 185 of the Companies Act. That was sufficient for me. With that, I was arguing the case. The audits are right now reserved in NCLT. In another case, the first case where the factory was sold, I took all the sale deeds and all that. I proved beyond doubt various sections and the objective of the law, what is the code and what is the status. And that's how it got forwarded to SFIU. And in the third case, you know, where there are asset tripping and, you know, heavy inventory vanished and the receivables did not come, I got a forensic audit done. And the forensic audit showed much more violations based on which I could file the application. In fact, I filed the application based on a statutory audit report because I could not take out the assets under Section 25. It was forwarded to the group companies. Then the adjudicating authority dismissed my application. Then I filed again the application along with the forensic audit report. Second time, they did not dismiss, but the respondents argued that res judicata is applicable because first time once under Section 66 is dismissed, she cannot file one more application. Then we had to argue that it's a fraud. In the case of fraud, res judicata is not applicable. So finally, that case is also forwarded to SFIO. The matter is pending in the Honorable NCLAT. So what I feel is, you know, the same persons, directors are there in various group companies. Look at all the group company transactions, subcontract arms, you know, the diversion of the funds. You know, many times what happens, the company is made a shell with no assets or with minimum assets. So the choice for the insolvency professional is not to liquidate a company. It is to look at the avoidable transactions, fraudulent transactions, and see how to maximize the value. That is what I have been trying to do in my cases. Only thing is, the challenge is that I have gone through hearings where it varies from 25 hearings to 30 hearings. I have gone through in each case, and many times, I know there are few lawyers who understand IBC and various others, laws and all together. So all my cases, I argue myself because I understand. I have understood and I have reported the fraud. So all my cases, I argue myself. And, you know, so the IP is the right person who can take up the case in the right manner with the insolvency, with the adjudicating authority. And, you know, in fact, in some cases, you know, they close down the factory, dump all the records into a godown, and hand over all the liabilities, including Section 138, under Section 138 filing also, it is forwarded to the resolution professional. We have to handle all liabilities, criminal cases, civil cases with no assets. So that's the pathetic situation. And unless we take it up through fraudulent take, it will be difficult. Yeah. Am I extending my time? So I think mostly I have gone through this. In fact, I will talk about the challenge. 2 minutes I will take. I will talk about the challenges. You know, see, finding the fraud is easy. We can educate all the professionals to work under Section 66. And they will use the professionals to arrive at the, to understand the fraud, file applications. However, finally, the order has to come from the adjudicating authority. The adjudicating authorities today, the way I understand, it's a complex issue even for them to understand. So like how we are all trying to educate the professionals, I request the regulator here. Number one, maybe a little more clarity in terms of the law and the regulations, plus the proper training to the adjudicating authorities also, like how we are trying to educate the professionals. Let us train the adjudicating authorities so that they appreciate the intention of the law, they appreciate the act of the resolution professional, and accordingly pass timely orders. I think that is the only challenge I feel, you know, we are facing under this section, you know. And also there should be a clarity, you know, we are giving a statutory audit report, we are giving forensic audit report. Finally, if it is forwarded to SFIO, our CIRP is not going to wait till SFIO investigation is complete. We don't know. There is no timeline for SFIO. Of course, I am fighting that case separately in the appellate tribunal, the same thing. But however, you know, by forwarding it to SFIO, we don't achieve the objective of the code. And the objective of the code is defeated, and the fraudsters know how to get out of it. So I feel from this angle, I feel the regulators, you know, have, and the MCA have to come out with proper guidelines, proper regulations, and so that we can do justice. Otherwise, you know, we put in a lot of effort. Yeah. And finally, if the justice is not delivered through proper orders, then it would be a waste. So with this, I would like to close my session, and
thank you.
I'm handing it over to you.
Thank you so much. So as she said, regarding transferring the case to SFIO, don't you think that the case can still be closed under IBC while the matter is still continuing with the SFIO?
No, actually, I have no idea on that. SFIO should look at criminal aspects, I believe. But quite a few are civil aspects, like the 66 refunding in the money is a civil aspect. I think an adjudicating authority is empowered, as very explicit in the code. The adjudicating authority is supposed to dispose of all the applications filed with them with a direction of whatever way. But if the facts are not clear, it can seek the help of SFIO or any other agency for investigation. But I believe most such matters would not require a separate investigation if the RP has done a good job or has used a forensic audit. But I think Mr. Murarka and Madam may be able to explain that. I have no idea on that.
Okay. So going forward, we say that an RP can appoint a forensic auditor and rely on that report. Now, if the RP relies on the forensic auditor's report, how much is his own responsibility in this case? I think everybody would be interested to know that.
Again, I am no expert in these areas, but as far as I know, there is no professional by law called a forensic auditor. And I think law does not define anywhere a forensic audit. What we generally mean that if there are irregular transactions, let's unearth it.
and it is not an exclusive domain of the so-called forensic auditor. This can be found out by an insolvency professional, by a common person, and I don't think, unless it is a really very camouflaged kind of thing, lot of cover up is there, where you need expertise, in many cases it would be obvious to a common person's eye. And insolvency professional is not also an ordinary professional having a professional background in one of the disciplines, having 10 years experience. I don't think everywhere he or she would take an excuse that I need an insolvency professional, I need a forensic auditor. The insolvency professional may take help from a forensic auditor or any other professional in any other work, but responsibility lies with the insolvency professional. He can't tell that because I had outsourced or handed over this responsibility to an advocate or a chartered accountant, I am absolved of this responsibility. If that were the case, the job would have been given to five professionals together. The job has been given to insolvency professional. He has been empowered to hire other professional to assist him or her. But that does not mean that the responsibility is shifted. If, for example, he gives the responsibility to a chartered accountant on some accounting aspects and that professional commits a mistake, the insolvency professional can't be absolved of his or her responsibility. So professionals are there to assist him. He is to take guidance, he has to supervise the professional, but in no way he can tell that I have passed on my responsibility to another person.
So the IP has the ultimate responsibility, come what
may. Absolutely. That's why it is the IP. The law says that only an insolvency professional can work as an IRP or RP. So there is no way that IP can avoid this responsibility. And in fact, if an IP tries to do that, he is no more an insolvency professional.
Mr. Murarka, you have some questions?
Yeah, there are a few questions which have come in. So, one question is, what is the guidance for insolvency professional for unearthing these kind of transactions? So, of course, there are precedents and this subject is developing, but what I think as a matter of guidance could be, the ultimate objective is maximization of value. To maximize value, we have to unearth these transactions, make determination and make application. For this, there are few simple things that probably a resolution professional can look at. For example, if the debtors have been increasing year on year, so there is a possibility that probably the turnover or the sales are fictitious. So that is something that can be looked into. For example, if there could be made an analysis on various types of expenses in the P&L account and the ratios by which they are changing, that could also give an indication whether there are any dubious expenses. Analysis of related party transactions could also help. An analysis on the sanction letters issued by banks can also be analyzed by the resolution professional to see whether there are any chances of evergreening or not. It has also been observed in certain cases that the promoter families, their members are there on the board of all the group companies, but once a company, a particular corporate debtor starts doing bad in the financial sense or the business health deteriorates, the key promoters or family members of the promoters, they step down from the board of such companies. This may also be an indication that this company is probably looking at or staring at an insolvency or a bad financial situation. Another question which has come here is whether the look back period will apply to only up to 2 years. I think the look back period prescribed or the relevant period prescribed is only for preferential transaction. But as far as section 66 is concerned, the language is very wide and I read it once again. Where the business of the corporate debtor has been carried out with the intent to defraud creditors or for fraudulent purpose and no period has been prescribed. So my personal feeling is that the look back period does not apply in case of section 66. Another question relating to the difference between 49 and section 66. While 49 talks about transactions defrauding creditors only with the limited sense of undervalued transaction, but section 66 is very wide in its ambit and it covers everything that possibly section 43 to 51 covers. As far as there is one more question on engaging forensic auditors. I think Sahu sir has already spoken on that subject. I would just like to add that, like Sahu sir rightly said, an insolvency professional is not an ordinary person. He already has a lot of expertise, competence and experience. But for example, in a situation where, you know, a corporate debtor is into a mining business and there are allegations that, you know, the output from the mining has not been accounted for, in such situation the insolvency professional could possibly take a plea that I do not understand what mining has been done and how much output has come out. So in those situations he may engage some experts, but the ultimate responsibility remains with the insolvency professional, as pointed out by Sahu sir. So madam, these were the questions that I had.
Yeah, Bhuvneshwari, we have sent you some questions. Have you seen those?
I'm not able to get into that. If you can tell me, I can answer. Is it possible?
Okay. Question which you can also answer. A financial creditor filed petition with NCLT for liquidation of one company. NCLT also accepted the petition and appointed one insolvency professional as IRP. After 2 months, if we find that the financial creditor already assigned their rights to someone 2 years back, in spite of this company filed petition against corporate debtor for liquidation, if this is the situation, what is the remedy now?
Yes, I have seen that question. See, the financial creditor includes even any assignee thereof. So, even the assigned person is a financial creditor. So, accordingly, if, in my opinion, if he has not submitted claim is already submitted by the financial creditor and the assignee automatically gets into place, if required, the resolution liquidator can get one more claim from the assignee. That's my view.
The financial creditor made the application, but he had already assigned the debt to somebody else 2 years ago.
Yes.
That means, did he have the locus to file an application when he is no more a creditor?
Right.
I think law does not allow that. He has misled the court, and there should be lawsuit take its own course against him. The rights are given under Section 7 to the financial creditors, and of course one can trigger even if there is a default to another financial creditor, but that has to be the first person to trigger has to be a financial creditor. But if he is no more a financial creditor and has completely assigned the debt, if he has a part of the debt, still he has right. But if he has completely assigned the debt, I don't think he should be allowed to file an application.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Can a mere suspicion on the part of the RP sufficient regarding involvement of a person under Section 66, or is it to be substantiated with more than that? I think it's clearly that it has to be a determination and not just a suspicion.
It has to be a determination, and there has to be evidence in the nature of corroborative evidence or direct evidence.
If a person against whom a charge is made by an RP approaches the High Court under Article 226, can the High Court entertain such a petition?
Read the question again.
If a person against whom a charge is made by an RP approaches the High Court under Article 226, can the High Court entertain such a petition?
No, the question is not clear. When you say charge has been made by IP,
charge means the.
I don't think IP is competent to make any charge against anybody. I am not too sure on that. And in any case, in what form he is approaching High Court? And there is no way the jurisdiction of High Court, such as a writ petition, can be taken away under or restricted under any circumstance. So I don't think that ordinarily, if it is just a resolution matter, then it's under Section 60, the matter should come to NCLT. But we do not know what from the question, it is not clear on what matter, what ground somebody is seeking the help of High Court, but High Court always has jurisdiction to entertain anything under it, jurisdictions or even PIL.
How far can a charge of fraud succeed if it is challenged that the adjudicating authority has decided it in a summary manner despite the charge being criminal in nature, which requires a full-fledged trial to prove it?
I am not sure that NDG professionals may answer that, but the adjudicating authority is not taking a call on a criminal aspect. Mm. The adjudicating authority is only taking a call on the civil aspect, and the standards required for these two are quite different. If it has to be pursued criminally, then it would come to IBBI or central government, and they will go to the special court to file a matter, and then the process will start. I am not too sure if the adjudicating authority can get into criminal side of it.
Right, sir. Is timeline of 75, section 75, 115 and 135 for determination, finding and application are strictly applicable to section 66 application?
I think probably that is the meaning of the law.
Yeah.
So, we can't be interpreting strictly, not applicable, mandatory, directory. I think the law requires us and we have to do it.
So, similar question is, if the timeline for filing application under 66 is lapsed, then what to do? Is there any alternate course of action?
I do not know. I think the adjudicating authority always has the jurisdiction to entertain an application after the timeline. But he should be, the IP who has missed the date has to be accountable why he did not do the job in time, unless he was prevented by the circumstances beyond his control. So, both things should be possible. The adjudicating authority should be able to entertain it with whatever due condonation, whatever provision is there, but the person who is responsible has to explain.
So, these are the major questions, and the time is also getting over. So, thank you so much, Sahu sir, for very elaborately explaining the provisions of the law and the responsibilities of the professionals there too. We are thankful to Madam Bhuvneshwari as well for sharing the nitty-gritties of how IPs can make the application, what they need to get into to understand that the fraud or fraudulent transactions have taken place. And thank you, Mr. Murarka, for being here and sharing your part of the law. So, before we conclude, I would just like to highlight for the benefit of all section 47, which provides for the penalty provisions. And it says that the where the IRP, RPO or liquidator have not reported undervalued transactions, a creditor or member or partner of the CD can file the application. After examination of application, if NCLT found that the transaction has occurred and the RPO or liquidator has not reported despite having sufficient information or opportunity to avail information of such transactions, the NCLT can pass order requiring IBBI to initiate disciplinary proceedings against the RP or liquidator. So, the penalty provisions are also there. So, any such applications have come before IBBI? Any such not reference yet, from not NCLT?
Yet, not yet in respect of these kind of matters.
Not yet. So, that means the RPs probably are doing their jobs, but we request all of you to kindly take this section 66 very seriously, and because that is the, as Dr. Sahu said, that is the heart and core of the law to protect the value and the, to maximize the value of the CD. Thank you all once again for being here. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.